Our mother, like, when I, God rest her soul, whenever she was talking, she was like, Christoph, our love will come later.
Mm-hmm.
You have to take a wife now. You know, so
facts.
That's the thing, and I understand it.
She
because
said, you said you don't have to take a wife.
No,
now?
She said you have to take a wife at your age.
Oh, so she's saying
that I need
get
to
married
take...
and then fall in love with
yeah,
a man.
Yeah, love will come later.
Yes.
This is a business arrangement. Love will come later.
Exactly.
I was thinking at first she was saying delay it. You're young, so just delay it. Nah, you'll get
not
love
the
later.
Woman that brought the arranged marriage to me.
Yeah,
no.
You're gonna get all that love stuff later. You need this is your duty. Go ahead and get married, bear some kids, and all this other stuff.
And hope you fall in love with it later.
Yeah, that's it. But that's what they were doing.
Yeah.
And you know, the great part about it was working in a sense, right? Because in our culture, it truly is a village.
Love is a treasure chest, but once opened, our hearts become vulnerable.
I went back to Vegas. It was this guy. He appeared as a friend. Sure enough, it led to infidelity.
Alignment can't be ignored.
We talked about certain topics as far as having kids. She didn't want to have kids. And that was one of the red flags.
And I know you desire marriage. So I think it's best you move on with your life.
What you do? Hold on, Lisa, what you do?
I told him, okay.
She didn't ask me why.
I knew several other women's bodies better than I knew my own. I watched their videos of them having sex, so I would try to imitate that.
No discussion is off limits. Dear Future Wifey podcast brings healing.
You inspire us to try God a little bit more.
But through this platform, I have realized that it's possible. It's possible to love again.
The conversations have really helped me to change my perspective on relationships.
Season 7 is all about tough topics. I'm Latarius R. Winfield, and welcome to the Dear Future Wifey podcast.
Welcome to the Dear Future Wifey podcast. I'm your host, Latarius R. Winfield. Listen, are you still shacking up with us? If you're still shacking up with us, come on, can we get a commitment? Hit that subscription button and subscribe. Make sure you turn on your notification bell so you'll be notified about upcoming episodes. Listen, if you're listening to us on Apple Podcasts or Google Podcasts or Spotify, make sure you leave a review and rank this video 5 stars. Man, we have been deep diving into tough topics on season 7. And man, today, this has been an episode I've been wanting to have a long time because we have such a huge fan base internationally. Shout out to Nigeria because, again, this episode is representing y'all again. Welcome to the Dear Future Wifey podcast. My new homies, Chris, Naja, King, Ibezim, and Olivia Ibezim. What's up, y'all?
Hey.
Thank you. Man. We are so grateful to be here, man. We watch your show all the time, and it's a huge honor.
Are you nervous?
You know what?
When you sit on that yellow couch, you end up saying some truth that you wasn't prepared to talk about.
Know.
You know, I'll find out everything. You know, that's the truth serum right
yeah,
there.
Yeah, so, I'm here for it, man.
You ready, Olivia?
I'm ready.
So I told the audience that this is a subject matter that I've always wanted to talk about, and that subject matter is arranged marriages.
Mm.
Y'all know anything about that?
No, a little bit.
Just,
no.
Just a little bit.
Our
whole life, you know.
So tell me that in your culture, is that something that they start telling you about early on, or is it something that's just understood?
All of the above.
Mm-hmm.
All of the above. It is, you watch it as you grow up. You're being told about this. Mm-hmm. You probably be your friend next to you. And y'all are just playing, but they've probably already arranged you guys for when you get older.
Hold on. As young as what?
Probably out the womb, but go ahead.
I remember.
Out the womb.
No. When I was like, I think 6 or 7 with Jackie, like I knew that was who I was supposed to be marrying. And I was a little
kid. When you were 6 or 7?
We were sitting on the
my
couch.
My god sister, Oklahoma, as a matter of
her god sister. We were holding hands on the couch. And
still got the picture.
Still got, yeah. Yeah.
So you knew that was supposed to be your wife?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What did you think about that?
I mean, when I'm young, that was just our lifestyle, our culture. Like, I just knew it at a young age.
That's your wife right there.
Yeah. I mean, Jackie's married now to an amazing man. Jackie, congratulations. I love
beautiful
her. I love
wedding.
The family. Their family is my family as well. So you just kind of knew. You know, that's just one of the things, like, growing up, we all kind of knew what was going to transpire later on because our parents was arranged and whatnot. And so,
right. And they were best friends, too. So especially when, like, as a matter of fact, you're going to probably talk about that later, but like when the parents are really, really close, that's another way to bond the family together. You already have heads up on what type of lineage that particular family has, you know, what the future holds, mm-hmm. and whatever, if they even have diseases, like you already know what's going on. So,
you know, I think that's when I think about arranged marriages, I don't see a problem with it. I think it's pretty cool. But then, of course, I wouldn't want nobody to arrange, make me marry somebody. You know what I'm saying? Uh-huh. It's like I love what it represents. Right. And I love the intentionality about it. Mm-hmm. But then in my own self, it's like, because I'm an individual. You can't just choose love for me.
And that's the hard part about the situation. We come into a family where we're headstrong. Mm-hmm. We love our independence. We like being individual. Individuals. But here's the thing. Tradition is tradition. Culture is culture. Mm-hmm. And there has to be a reason why they're saying, look, I want this family to mate with this family so we can have this for the future.
Do they ever explain that?
Bingo. Yeah, well, we had those conversations, our uncles and aunts. You got to think about it. All right, Latera, let's say you and I are best friends.
Right.
We've been growing together, playing ball together, everything. I know everything about you. You know everything about me.
Right.
You have a child. I have a child. The love I have for you is going to transition to our children.
Facts. Right.
So I'm going to know the household that your child comes from because of our relationship. So you think about, you have this royal family. Let's connect them in marriage and union. You know, and that's the premise of it, because you want the best for your child.
Absolutely.
And whoever I know growing up, their kid is going to be the best in my eyes because I know that individual.
So y'all are brothers and sisters.
Yes.
Did you have somebody picked out for you? What happened, Olivia? Come on, talk about it. Did you have a little boo thing that was arranged when you were 6 years old?
Oh my God. So I don't know how young it was. However, I remember coming back from school. I went to UAPB, University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff. I remember coming home one winter. Mm-hmm. And I happened to be in the den, and I noticed that there was a knock on the door. Now, mind you, my older sister said,
I've heard about the knock on the door.
It's the knock. Yeah. But I called my sister's bluff. She said, hey, somebody from New York is coming. Mm-hmm. I said, what do you mean for who? Now, mind you, I am the one you can't tell anybody.
You're hard-headed.
Oh, I'm the hard-headed one.
I hold lenience. She was... Oh my goodness.
You ain't gonna just make Olivia do nothing.
You're not gonna make me do what I don't wanna do. Mm-mm. But I think I was scared out of my wits. So the knock happened. And there was a man, young man, and there was a mother.
Uh-oh.
And I guess they took DFW. I don't know. I guess they came from one of them airports. And I remember thinking, this cannot be happening to me. Are they really going to throw me into something that I don't want to do? So I pretended like I was asleep. in the den.
True story.
And I kept peeking. And when I find someone getting up, I hurried up and ran to the couch and I fell asleep. And I try to pretend so they know not to make me mad when I'm asleep. But that was my true story. That actually happened.
Did you ever find out who this guy was?
So what had happened was...
Even in Nigeria, they say, what had happened with us? That's the Negro phrase to let you know that this story is finna go to another level. So what had happened was...
So I don't know if they told the man that I wasn't there. I don't know what happened. I just know my mother knew that I probably would have made an embarrassment moment out of that. Mm-hmm. And so, but I did get the number. The guy and I did speak, but I kind of like pulled back. So it never became anything. I never even got to.
Did you even see him?
I saw him through the crack. Like I saw him like, I don't even know what that man looked like anymore.
That fear set in.
So let me ask you this. Did you desire marriage?
I always did. I desired marriage for as long as I can remember. Disney said you needed a prince on a white horse. Yeah. No, I wanted to do yoga with mine. I wanted to touch mine. I wanted to do prayers with mine. Yeah. So, yes, I did.
So it wasn't the fact that they're forcing marriage on you. It's the fact that you always want to reserve the right to choose your
Correct. Yeah. But again, it's that explanation. It though they hinted to it a lot, and I mean a lot.
A lot.
I think had they spoken to us how I felt like they should have spoken to us, and that there it go again, and me wanting what I wanted.
Tell me how that speech should have gone.
I think for us being raised up here, we had to straddle the fence. There's a difference when you grow up in a country where It's on a daily. It's on a constant. Now, every here we day, are, yeah. born here. Know that everybody lives on their own merit, to be exact. I think if they would explain to us, this is what it looks like. Or we went home a lot, you know, just to get that experience, then I don't think we would have ran from it the way we did.
Would have been as resistant.
Yes, because now it's a little bit different, won't you say?
We understood it because, like, our mother, like, when I got rest her soul, whenever she was talking, she was like, Christopher, love will come later.
Mm-hmm.
You have to take a wife now. You know, so
facts.
That's the thing, and I understand it.
She said you don't have to take a wife.
No,
now?
She said you have to take a wife at your age.
Oh, so she's saying
that I need
get
to
get married
take...
and then fall in love with
a
lady.
Yeah, love will come later.
Yes,
this is a business arrangement. Love will come later.
Exactly.
I was thinking at first you were saying delay it. You're young, so just delay it. Nah, you'll get
not
love
the
later.
Woman that brought the arranged marriage to me.
Yeah,
no,
you're gonna get all that love stuff later. You need this is your duty. Go ahead and get married, bear some kids, and all. This other stuff.
And hope you fall in love with it later.
Yeah, that's it. But that's what they were doing.
Yeah.
And, you know, the great part about it was working in a sense, right? Because in our culture, it truly is a village.
Yeah,
in
it is.
Every aspect, as far as like raising kids, burying somebody, traveling. If people come to America, we're obligated to let them live with us until they get on their feet.
I heard.
You know, it's just no ifs, ands, buts about it. So marriage is the same way. You know, it's a whole. It's a whole like community event when you get married if that's African.
Like your mother-in-law can come and stay with you, come when she wants.
When she
don't
want.
Have to call you. Again, that is that respect factor once it's arranged. Does that make sense? Like that all comes with that.
You know what? I'm trying to see if I want to reveal too much. All right, I dated a Nigerian woman.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And so I got introduced to that. And I was just like, I thought it was really cool. But it's like if they were to come to come to the United States or whatever, you always know, like they have this network.
We do.
Yes. It's like, if you in Dallas, they be like, oh, we're going to call so-and-so, so-and-so. You're going to always feel protected. You're going to always be covered.
You're going to
have
drivers. You're going to have
taken care of.
You probably haven't even seen them. Yes. Mm-hmm.
That's just how I work. And that's why for a Nigerian man, we preach hard. And this is a big thing on me. Like, I have to have a submissive woman.
Yeah.
It's just no ifs, ands, buts about that.
What does submission look like to you?
Man, great question. So to me, it's so important, but I have to be a man worthy of her submission, right?
Right.
And so that's the thing, because we also submit to our woman in aspects as well, too, because the woman really controls everything. You know, a lot of people getting their egos. So, yes, I'm going to make the final decision, but my woman is directing me. So she's really in charge.
How does that look? So you say that a woman really controls everything.
Mm-hmm.
You're saying in your culture, you're talking about in your life.
In my life and culture. But the man makes that final decision.
Right.
But if your woman is doing the things that a woman in our culture do, how can you tell them no?
So do you think that women in your culture have a significant voice? Do you feel like that is cultivated where their voices are heard? And I'm gonna ask Olivia.
Yeah,
next.
I feel the voices are heard, but that man does make that final decision.
Olivia, what do you say?
Once upon a time, I felt like it wasn't because I was so headstrong. I was so quote unquote independent in my own rights that I didn't want to hear what anyone had to say. I didn't want you to tell me how to move and where to move. Right. I also do. Blame that on the fact that my father died at a very early age.
How old were you?
So I was actually 5. He was an infant.
Yeah, I was.
And so I didn't get to really see that dynamic. So now here we are talking about the fact that not only are we in a society where everybody does their own thing, choose stuff, but now I have to fall victim to a single mother. So now I have to see a very dominant female play a role that is really out of nature.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Out of nature's design. And so here we are trying to pick back up. This is why Chris and I are saying, yeah, we wanted to choose, but we also believe in arranged marriages because it really does put into place, enforce the traditions, the culture, like everything is as solidified as possible. Now you're thinking about future bloodline.
Yeah. So when you, So back on you, Chris, because of course this is always a taboo subject when you talk about submission, and so you get this, you get this narrative, especially with Nigerian men, is like y'all are very controlling and that type of stuff. But it was a different perspective that you offered, where you just said, "No, my woman will run everything. I have the final say. I have to be somebody worthy for her to submit to." Mm-hmm. Always say that there can be no submission unless there's first a mission. Mm-hmm. So a man has to be able to articulate that mission, how he sees the family going, goals, exactly, and the things that the family has to have. Exactly. And then she submits. She comes under the mission and says, "I can undergird that mission." And
well
so
said.
For yeah, you as that. A amen. So for you as a Nigerian man, you said a woman has to be submitted to me. What have you encountered where it has yielded a different result?
The first thing, I always talk about communication, right? And I also talk about the tone of the communication.
Yes.
That's very, very important. I feel that as a woman and a man interaction, right? This is the person that's your soulmate, your twin flame, whatnot. I shouldn't have to handle you like I handle someone outside of our household.
Good.
You know, so I think about that. So if you're going to be soft with me, that's going to allow me to be the man I need to be for you.
Teach.
And I'm always going to have a plan for us. And I'm always going to let you know that plan so you can help me along the way. You know, so I feel that that's the part where we coexist, and you have that submission on both. Like, she has to trust me enough to let me lead, and I have to show her that I'm worthy of leading us to where we're trying to go. So a lot of people, it's like, if you broke, you shouldn't be dating. You know, that's how I feel about it. It is what it is.
What is broke?
If you can't afford for y'all to go somewhere and y'all get a nice meal and a drink, you need to stay at home. So, and it's serious. I mean, I truly believe that, because there's a lot of individual, and I feel if you're a woman, if you can't take care of yourself, you don't need to be out there trying to find a man. If your hygiene ain't right, if your mind isn't right, you're not well studied in aspects, you know. So I think people do a lot of that dating stuff, but not getting themselves prepared to date.
Olivia, you're there smiling. What was that a trigger?
Because I'm so proud of him. I mean, you know, I think I want to say it was Marvin who you had on there, or I can't remember, but they said vetting is important.
Yeah, Marvin Sapp.
Love him. And so vetting means you have an understanding as to what the traditions you want in your household needs to look like, i.e. culture.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. i.e. traditions. Like, that makes sense. And that's where the mission that he's talking about, the plan that he's talking about, comes into play. I come to you with a plan. You feel your discernment not only kicks in, but you trust me enough to lead us. I'm still your neck. You can't turn your head without me.
Right.
Like one of my friends told me.
Yeah.
And that's what he's trying to say. The way you talk to me, you can catch more bees with honey than you can with vinegar. Mm-hmm. And that's why I'm proud of him. Like, he said it on point.
So, Olivia, where has your dating life looked like, Miss Headstrong?
Listen.
Oh, her dating life done. She's done.
Yeah.
You wrapped up? What?
I'm done.
Yeah, we'll approve of that one.
You approve of it?
And I was so nervous.
Why?
I went from doing my own thing to realizing that they are the head of my household. And I can't be with anybody that does not fit their plan. Mm-hmm. I can't move without my brothers. They are the head of not only the household here, but the household in Nigeria. You got to understand, my father was the first son of the king. And so that, now that he's passed, it goes down to our older brother and so on and so on.
You said the first son of the king.
Correct. Mm-hmm.
So that's where you get Naja King from?
Yeah.
So anyway, it wasn't just a little moniker.
No, it wasn't. Yeah, it's facts, yeah.
It wasn't just no little rap name or something. I'm Naja King up in this mother. No, like for real.
Yeah.
So you said your brothers, we're going to talk about that, about... So the guy that, are you engaged officially or what?
Listen, it's coming.
Okay.
Yeah, it's
so y'all, yeah, so it's just
this is
because
there are
one.
Things that has to
I know
happen.
It's a whole
yeah,
list.
It's a whole situation.
I'm saying you date a Nigerian and get ready to go through that whole thing.
It's a whole ritual.
Go to the village and all this stuff.
Yeah.
So and I didn't realize it. What seems like an engagement don't really be an engagement.
No.
Be like something else y'all call it. And then let's walk through that. So what is the process?
Ooh, it's long.
It's a long
so I'm
going
to try to.
Yeah, it's
so, okay, so so right now, really, I had to go through them first
right.
before we can bring
Who
them to
them?
The Kingsmen. My older brother and the two younger brothers, like, he had to fit their criteria for me. They know that I'm a bit rough, so how can he calm me down?
He's a bit rough.
And then after that, once that happened, after they go through that, they have to go to the Kingsmen, whether it is them having to do the uncles that are here, or we also and or have to
go to Nigeria.
Yeah, go to Imo State, yes.
Yeah. And so you got to go to the village. How long did the vetting take place with you and the brothers?
It took some time because you got to think about it like this. Until your sister takes a husband, she's your
responsibility. Right.
So regardless, wherever she needs anything, I'm obligated to be there, whether it's emotionally, spiritually, financially, mentally. We're basically her husband until she get the husband.
And see, that's the stuff I love about the culture. That type of stuff. Really big into family. And so let's quantify how long did that process take when you talking to Vietnam?
I would say it was almost probably like a year, because when I look at a man for my sister, I think about a lot of things. All right, can he protect her? Can he fight? You know what I'm saying? Is he financially stable? You know,
How you test if you fight? You and your brother go pick a fight with him?
No, I can tell by a man's demeanor. Yeah, that's pretty much it. He ain't got to win the fight. I want at least as long as he try.
He'll go defend
he'll
her.
He'll defend her. He ain't no
punk.
Bingo.
Yeah.
At all. Yeah, he's a manly man, you know.
He sure is.
Financially stable. I always, how's he with his children? Because I got a nephew, and that's going to be his kid.
Yeah.
How's he in adversity? How's he in business? Because I even do business with him. You know, his patience. That's very, very important, because my sister's a handful. She's worth it, but she's a handful. So
she don't have no qualms about it. She knows.
I got to all those questions. Have those hard one-on-one man conversations, you know. And then he follows up with his actions, and he's proven that. So, I'm happy we got him.
So if he didn't approve of him.
It wouldn't have happened.
So do all the brothers have to, all the people have to approve?
Pretty much.
Pretty much. Well, let me say, this is to where my good. American I.
He said, what did he say, Chris? What did you say, Chris?
I'm letting some stuff.
Oh, Jesus. For me, this is where the Americanized part really comes in. I've solidified who really is important to me.
Good.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And that's the three. And so my three brothers. And like he said, I am their responsibility. My son is their responsibility until someone comes in that can measure or surpass most of them, right? So that means I'm not going to wait for my uncles. Sorry, uncle.
I knew that's what you were getting at when you said I solidify.
But again, not only are they the ones that mean the most to me, right? But they also are the first son's children. So anything that happens in my family, in our compound, right? Because we have a compound. It goes through them first. You just can't do anything without coming to them.
Good.
Especially the older brother. Now, that also solidifies the fact that that man will respect me because I come from somewhere. You just can't handle me any old type of way, right?
Yeah. You got people you got to answer to.
You got to handle me with care.
Chris said, let's be clear. Chris said, that's why I said you better make sure you can fight.
No, seriously. You might not can win, but.
You're going to catch your hands by about three dudes.
Yeah, it's serious.
About three dudes finna get you.
No,
I be seeing
your
videos on IG.
Oh, man.
Nobody want the problems.
American versus Nigeria now.
Yeah, it's a
be a whole war.
Different.
So then. So you respect them to the point that they said you wouldn't buck like a young girl with a temper tantrum and be like, but I love you and I don't care what y'all say.
Not happening, because at the end of the day, they're still a man that recognized man.
I can't do something that I'm not designed or equipped to be.
You better hold on. You girl.
What is the truth?
I think she done told, man.
It's the truth.
That is so powerful.
Mm-hmm.
I need you to say that again.
No.
Because that's because I think sometimes women feel like I know more than I've had homegirls that they'll ask me about a certain guy, I'll be like, nah, that guy sucks, 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 sucks.
Right.
Like, you think you know everything. Mm-hmm. You just, I said, oh, I forgot you and I both had penises at the same time. Time I wake up and say, I ain't got no penis. That's my point. So how you gonna tell me what a man looks like and how people move? And every single time, time will pass and they be like, you were right.
Yeah.
I said, because I'm a man. Like, you're asking a man's opinion about something.
Right.
Got a call yesterday from a friend and she asked me about this particular guy that always meets with her for business lunches, but he does it every couple of months. He'd be like, hey, yeah, let's do lunch or whatever. And she said, but I like him. You know, how should I handle that situation? I said, well, to be honest with you, if he only takes you for lunch and it's every couple of months, he's just showing enough interest to keep you dangling, but he's not, I feel like he got a whole nother situation going on. Mm. So he can justify it by just saying, oh no, I just go to lunch for her. You know, we talk about business.
Right.
He hasn't stepped all the way out and said, hey, let's go to dinner. Let me actually pursue you and court you. And he says he'll slip up sometimes and be like, so babe, I shouldn't be saying that. You know, it's a professional thing. I say he throws that out there as bait to see how you hook on to it. And he'd be like, no, I like it when you say that. He'd be like, oh. So then if you become the initiator, whatever happens from that relationship, he says, I was never trying to talk to you. I was trying to keep professional. Mm-hmm. You the one that started asking, can we go meet up and can we do this or whatever?
Right.
And he'll have you on the hook on that. And he may have a whole nother situation going on. She's wise enough to say, I respect that. That's why I called you. But you'll have some people, they'd be like, oh, no, I'm a, like Ariel Fitzpatrick. She has this funny IG girl on TikTok. She's like, I'm going to see for myself. And so some people be like, I'm going to go see for myself and go ahead and make a train wreck out of it all. But I love the fact that you said, as a woman, you recognize these are men. So if they looking at this dude, they not hating on you. It's not like they saying, I don't want my sister to ever have nobody. You know, they saying, I want you to be somebody because you a little pricey. It costs a little, you know I got to take care of you.
Right.
So at the end of the day, I want you to be with the best option. And
absolutely.
I'm not trying to block you. I'm not trying to hate on you. I don't want you to be single for the rest of your life. And I want to be able to co-sign and willingly, because the way y'all culture is set up, that this is his family member now.
Absolutely.
That he got to be able to rock with this dude.
Absolutely.
And he already talking about he do business with the dude and all that.
He does.
Yeah.
He does. Absolutely.
Yeah.
It's really important. I think if you get burnt enough, if you put your hand on the stove enough, I think at some point you, as an individual, not even a woman, but also a man, as an individual, you start to ask yourself, okay, I need to take a step back. I really need to ask people that actually look like the person that I'm trying to date.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, you know, because everybody sold their royal oats, you know, and you know, some got it, some didn't.
Yeah.
But I did not want to continue a path that wasn't conducive for me, let alone my child, which is a boy.
Yeah.
Does that make sense? Like now he's living, you know, I just couldn't do it.
Yeah.
Was there a situation in the past where your brothers, where you weren't so agreeable?
I was engaged.
You was engaged that they like him?
I
Nah. See, I didn't even know about that till later on. So yeah.
So why'd you keep it away from him?
She
remember
knew
what you said about what some girls be doing?
I'm gonna
see for myself.
I came engaged. You're not even understanding.
You just showed up and said,
I showed up with a whole ring, a whole 3-carat, and this is who I want to be with. But were my intentions pure? Did I see red flags?
Did you?
I saw a whole bunch of them, but I didn't want them to stop me, because at this point I wanted to, the person that put the leech on me, her foot on my neck had passed. Now I can do what I want to do, because had my mother been alive, that wouldn't have
that
took
wouldn't
place.
Have happened,
really?
Why not? Not at all.
Why? What would have happened?
My mother was tradition.
Yeah. And it's like you don't want to be an embarrassment by getting out of line with,
absolutely,
with tradition.
We didn't have our kids, what, until after she
was... Yeah, she passed. Like, yeah.
We start popping them out.
Seriously. Yeah. And even with us...
Olivia, you said, oh, she's going, well, I'm going to be free.
Yeah, I'm going to be free.
So if she was alive and y'all had a kid out of wedlock, how's that looked upon?
Is it with
males, is it frowned upon as much as with women?
I think it was easier for you.
It would have been easier for me. It would have been.
It was harder for me.
Yeah, it would have been easier for
me. My older brother, love him. I love you, brother. Yeah. It was easier for him. Yeah. We loved on my niece, but I remember coming back from Nigeria saying, hey, brother, I'm pregnant. First of all, it was scary because I didn't tell any of them. I finally told him, the second person.
Yeah.
But the oldest, it was, oh my God, just thinking about it gives me, PTSD. Yeah. But I remember his words, like it was like Moses hearing from God. You remember the Ten Commandments, that sound?
Moses.
Like, I'm disappointed in you. I said,
sound like Mufasa.
Mufasa.
You know, because I like to think that I am my oldest brother's best friend. Like, he could tell me any or anything. Now, mind you, that's the, but he tossed me up like I was, because I was a tomboy. But when I told him that I was with child, the words have yet to leave me. It was the most embarrassing moment of my life. I hid until my child was born.
Oh, for real?
I'm not lying.
Yeah.
I hid
my pregnancy. I stayed at a best friend's house. A mutual friend of ours knew about it.
Well, how old were you? You was grown, wasn't you?
Yes, I was, 31, 32?
Yeah. So she hiding?
I hid. Nobody knew that I came. I was so embarrassed. Nobody knew I came back from Nigeria. Mm-hmm. I was in the U.S. hiding.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yeah.
And not being married. And, you know, one of my arguments was, well, you didn't arrange me no marriage, so why you... I'm serious. That's what I told him. But I was hurt.
Yeah.
You know.
So you didn't arrange me. Try to project it on him.
Seriously.
Your legs up, go get pregnant.
Hey, you got to flip the script. Listen. You didn't arrange nothing, so I did what I wanted to do. But he's a blessing. Love my baby.
And it's the same way, just like how we have to vet individuals, it's the same way with the women we bring to the table, too.
Absolutely.
So you listen,
Absolutely. You know, because as men, we get tunnel vision, right?
Yeah.
So we're going to miss these cues that women... I feel women have the best intuition. You know, I think God is a black woman. I always say that. So they're going to know more than us, especially when it comes to another female. Oh, she's using you, or she's not your type. She's this and that. So you got to take heed to that. Because we get blind on looks and...
the other stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
So let me ask you this. Was there moments where she's told you that girl ain't good for you?
And I did.
Yeah.
And I did.
Yeah.
She right?
Yeah. Yeah, she's absolutely right.
How long did it take for you to actually acknowledge and tell her, you was right about it?
It was multiple times. Sometimes it was quick. Sometimes it took a year or two, because, sometimes we'd be like, well, I know what I'm doing, this and that. But she's always right. Yeah.
I think for him, ultimately, there has to be a woman that really, truly loves God the way our family love God. I want you to surpass us in loving God.
Ooh.
I dare you to, but I want you to love on God, court God way past us. Because his sister and I, our discernment is just on extra.
Yeah, it is.
You know, so people think about physical. They might think about mental. A lot of people neglect spiritual. You cannot be physically fit yet mentally and spiritually obese. It will not work. So... when these women come, they are infatuated with the outside. Can you pray the enemy up out of him?
Teach.
Mm-hmm.
Can you calm his mental when the world is trying to beat him up?
Teach.
He's not trying to be a male chauvinist by saying, you have to be calm about how you speak to me. Because your words alone is going to plant life, better yet, cultivate the life in me so we can build this empire that you're looking to get your Birkin on. But
she said, you're looking to get your Birkin on.
So that's why sometimes he takes his time trying to present a woman to me, because I will read you up and down, not with my words, but with my spirit.
Yeah. So, Chris, how old are you?
I'm 40 now.
At 40, being a Nigerian man, unmarried, is that frowned upon?
Well, I would say our culture wants to get married as soon as possible.
At what?
As far as it being...
What's that soon?
20s, 30s, something like that, you know?
They want a bunch of kids.
So it's about kids?
Yeah.
Yeah, lineage, like...
Your lineage has to be long and strong.
Mm-hmm.
It's so when you start pushing, getting to 30, if your mom, when did your mom pass away?
She passed, I was 27, I think. That was
19.
Yeah, probably about 2019, something like that. Yeah.
And so how old were you around that time?
I can't do math.
32 or something, or 31.
I want to say about I just hit 30.
Right at 30, yeah.
30, 31, I want to say. I don't know.
So
were
you feeling a bunch of pressure from her about not being married?
I felt pressure for myself.
Mm-hmm.
You know, yes, my mother spoke wisdom into me, but I also knew that my downfall was my temperament because I wanted to be such an independent individual. I wanted to be able to be free to be me. But again, tradition is so important because if you don't have a direction, where are you going to go?
Facts.
Yeah.
And the pressure was on me because of my temperament. And I strayed away from the dating scene, per se, because of my temperament.
Yeah. I mean, we were worried.
They were very worried.
Yeah. We were like, man, you're going to have to be a special somebody. and sure enough, that's why God can do anything. I feel...
God proved himself.
He proved himself.
I don't think enough arranged marriage would have helped this situation at the time it was happening, honey. But... God is faithful.
And so y'all witnessed arranged marriages with other siblings, right?
Correct.
And that's both your older brothers?
Yes.
So both your brothers had arranged marriages. What did that look like to y'all, watching that take place?
I mean, I loved it. My brother's wife is amazing.
The oldest one. Oh, my God. Even the youngest one. Like, ugh.
Jude, his wife...
She's beyond amazing.
So they were arranged at what point? Was it again from when they were younger?
They were young.
I think he was either old. He was born first because their parents were best friends. They stayed, you could say, Highland Hills and Keyson Polk. That's how close they were
pretty close,
right?
Yeah.
For those of you in Dallas. But they were best friends. And so they already
She
probably wasn't even born yet.
Yeah.
I don't know, but...
He looked at his wife's stomach and said, that's going to be your wife.
That's all you.
It was before she came out the oven.
And the most amazing woman...
That is interesting
...you could ever meet. Like, she is for my brother and their children and her household. She will, by far, give everything she have to that family. And I am so in love with her. Like, I'm getting teared up because I like how she takes care of my brother and my nieces and nephews. Mm-hmm. And again, arranged marriages, we're not against. We just didn't know much that we needed to know to really be submissive to it.
Yeah.
You know what's so amazing about that? Like, from the very beginning, it's like you said, like, from the very beginning, that's your wife. What does that look like growing up? Like, that means I can't go date somebody else?
I mean, you can date right now, but when it's time to get married, that's your wife. Yeah.
That's it.
You got to tell a woman you're dating, like, you know this ain't going nowhere, right? I'm just letting you know. Because I already got a wife that's spoken for, but we're going to do what we do.
It was like that. Because even when I was in college, I had uncles and aunts that would send me so many pictures of women on WhatsApp wanting me to choose which one. And, like, it was coming at a weekly basis. And with their bio, this one time it was twins or whatever.
Seriously,
just background. He's like, man, I just couldn't do it. I just couldn't. Mm-mm.
Though we grew up with it, it was still foreign.
Yeah.
You know, I think communication is so key. Everybody talks about that. But you got to know how to break it down to a child. You got to teach them. And that's what I like about stars, like people like the NBA stars that actually put in the work, like Kobe, from a young age.
Yeah.
It's the same thing with that. You start cultivating those kids so early. They're not going to shy away nor turn away from actual culture, actual tradition. My mother was only by herself. Had my father been in a household, and we're talking about the first son of the king.
Different ball,
this would have been arranged. Yeah. We probably wouldn't be looking at you.
No. I wouldn't be on no show.
You wouldn't be on no Rent and Love.
No, I don't thank you for allowing me to be on the show, but I wouldn't be here.
He wouldn't be here. So, yeah, we didn't even talk about that. This face looks very familiar. You know him from the first season of Ready to Love here in Dallas. They always do two seasons, and he's on the current season of Ready to Love here in Dallas, the beautiful city, my home city, born and raised here in the D. And so what did you think about him going on that show?
I was all for it, business-wise.
Yeah, she was.
Business-wise, you didn't think he was going to find love?
To me, no, it wasn't that. I was looking forward to it. However, comma, I still would have had to vet her, too. I think for him, he's such a beautiful soul. I wanted...
He said, Tommy, you ain't got nothing to do with this.
At all.
I am going to
at
vet
all.
Him.
At all. I think for him, I wanted the world to see him. It's almost like putting him on this platter. Remember how they did Simba?
Yeah.
That's how I looked at Yes, that's how I looked at Ready to Love. I wanted his pool for choosing to open up. Sorry, I just wanted that to happen.
And I'm learning a lot of this right now. Just so y'all know. So if y'all see some facial expressions, that's because I'm learning a lot now.
I wanted his pool to open up. You know, and so who wants to keep all that goodness to themselves? Like, I think his time to have a mate that is designed for him should come. But again, I'm not God. God has the final say. So he's the best CEO ever. So I'm not trying to take his place. But I think in order to present him, he needed to be on there.
So let me ask you this, Chris. You don't, I'm telling you, I can assume this and correct me if I'm wrong. You ain't got a problem beating a woman. Before the show, you ain't never had no problem meeting no woman.
Nah.
Okay. Because it'd be different if you was some ugly dude. You know what I'm saying? Like, you're attractive. You're Nigerian. A lot of these women be like, you know, you hit them with that. I know you can, because I heard you switching to that, switching to the accent. You can go there with it. You're fit. I see you on Instagram. So you ain't got, and you got some money. So you ain't got no problem meeting no woman. So what you talking about, Olivia? He need to open up the dating pool. He on Instagram.
Well, so
hold on, watch this. How many followers you got on Instagram?
105.
Okay. How many did you have before the show?
Like 105.
Exactly. It wasn't no different. That's what I'm saying. So he have about 100,000. When boy, you had to open up the dating pool.
So Terry, check
no
this
help.
Out though.
Talk to me, Olivia.
But like, when you have something precious to you, what do you normally do when it's precious?
Hold it close.
Exactly. I needed those parents that was holding their good kids close, their good daughters. I needed the pool to open up. You understand? Like, I wanted that to open up. I'm on a mission here.
Have you ever tried to connect them with somebody?
Have I?
No. Think so.
So the American side of me wanted him to be free to do him because I have a lot of words that we say together, like, this the bestie, right? Yeah. Outside of my boo thing, this the bestie.
Yeah.
And so I try my best to not infringe on his idea of a female, but we also try to remind him where we come from. Like, that's the best way I could put it. That's the words we use in our household. Remember where you came from. And so when he does that, are they seeking you just for how you look,
right,
what you can give, or do their heart truly know how to handle you?
Let me ask you this, because she said something really important that I can't let just fly by. She said she wants a woman for you that can pretty much outlove the love that they have for God. Is that important for you? Do you want a godly woman
to
the
degree? That we have for God. That's very, very important. Because I think about your principles and your foundation, your fundamentals, right? So when you have all these other things, it's like in sports, you always revert back to your fundamentals when you get tired. So think about in a relationship when you're exhausted and you don't have any more, you're going to revert back to your fundamentals.
Teach.
You know, so that part does make so much sense. You know, if you're not rooted in God, knowing that it's a higher, you know, higher being in yourself, then we don't really have anything to talk about.
Have you ever dated a woman that just didn't have a strong relationship, didn't even care about God?
It's a lot of them out here like that.
Did you date them?
Yeah, I did date one. And then, but I was, thinking, okay, maybe I can change this person.
Right.
You know, that's the younger me. And so realizing that we're not here to force anybody. We have to flow.
Right.
So people have to decide, you know, I want to wake up every day choosing my woman, and she wakes up choosing me every day.
Facts.
Just like I choose my friends. You know, I want you to be like, man, I'm going to call Chris. How you doing? I'm going to call you. How you doing?
Yeah.
We're choosing to spend our time together because that's the most valuable. I mean, we can, you have millions and millions of dollars, but the time is way more precious than that. So, so yeah, the loving the Lord and being spiritual is very, very important.
And y'all have always been like that?
Yes, we had no choice. Mm-hmm. We had to wake up at five.
Four in the morning.
To do what?
And pray. We all had... I would pray for the things. She prayed for forgiveness. My mom prayed for protection. Like, we'd be up at 4 o'clock in the morning praying, and we half sleep. I fell asleep when it was my turn. They had to hit me to wake up.
Because we about to get in trouble.
Because we were getting in trouble.
Every morning.
Yeah, had to, like, before going to school, I was in high school at the time. So, middle school too. That's just what it was.
I love that.
Yeah.
I love it. Mm-hmm. I love it. I absolutely love it. Because I wonder, because the way she emphatically said that at the very beginning, I was like, well, God, no. Like, how much y'all love God? She said, it's going to be pretty hard for you to do this. But the fact that that was a core belief mm-hmm. for her, and saying that that's the type of woman that she wants for you. And you tried it the other ways, has not worked. Mm-hmm. And so you're saying right now, the woman that you would choose, the woman mm-hmm. that you want to say I do to, is a woman that's rooted and grounded strongly with a firm foundation in Christ.
Have to be. Yeah.
What have you thought about his dating on the show?
It's interesting. I think those were a lot of amazing women on that show, but I also can tell the difference in culture for us. Mm-hmm. Nothing against those amazing women. I got a chance to meet them. I love them dearly, every last one of them. It's just, again, because of the things that he say, it's a turnoff for them in their ear. When you say submission, a lot of people start to cringe. But why are you cringing?
Because it's a cuss word to them. Because a lot of times men have used that as a form of abuse.
Yeah,
and
true.
So when they hear it, it's a biblical thing. And the Bible says, submit ye one to another. And so mm-hmm. we always hear it from the standpoint of a woman need to submit to her man. But the Bible says, submit ye one to another.
Exactly.
And so what he was saying at first, he said, I want a woman that's going to submit to me. And he said, and I will submit to her too. But a lot of times that's the throwaway. And the woman will jump in and be like, submit. See, that's what you want to control me. That's what's wrong. I want to control. And it's like, at your job, don't you submit to your boss?
Every day.
Your kids, do you ever want them to submit to you? Did you ever submit to your parents?
Day.
If the police told you to stop, are you going to submit to him? You'll be like, you ain't finna stop. I'm going to keep on driving. You know what I'm saying? It's such an unhealthy viewpoint when it comes to relationships, because mm-hmm. they look at it as a sense of giving up their autonomy, giving up their right to something. And at the end of the day, when the Bible says the two shall become one, that's the most beautiful thing that you could ever have, is that when you have yourself submitting to someone. One of the biggest examples that we saw biblically with the most powerful being that ever walked was Jesus Christ. He submitted himself over. Mm-hmm. And you can't kill Jesus. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
He had to submit himself. He said, all right, I'm gonna let y'all take me. Y'all ain't doing nothing. You know, I'm gonna let y'all take me. But he submitted himself. And so we don't realize the power of submission. The power of submission, what he said earlier that I want to touch on is that he said the way that the tone of a woman. See,
there you go, T.
He said the tone.
Go for it.
He said the tone
go
of a woman.
Go for it. Thank you.
The tone of a woman can make a man acquiesce to whatever she needs. But mm-hmm. if she sit there and be like, see, you don't do this and you don't, he be like, or if he can, just the tone, I'm going to have her say this. If she says, you don't spend time with me. You don't spend time with me. He'd be like, what do you mean I don't spend time with you? What are you talking about? He's going to automatically respond like that. He'd be like, you don't spend time with me. It's coming out very strong. He'd be mm-hmm. like, and then he's going to get defensive. He'd be like, you don't spend time with me. Or even mm-hmm. flip it and say, I wish you would spend more time with me. He'd be like, mm-hmm. what you need, baby? What's going on? I don't know. It's like when you're around me, you know, I really like mm-hmm. being around you. That tone, operating in that feminine spirit, then he's going to mm-hmm. automatically be, he's going to lay his sword down.
Bingo.
But the minute you start coming at him, You're going to pick the sword, try to fight. Bingo. Especially if you're talking to a man. Like a man, the mm-hmm. way you handle him a certain way, he is operating in such masculinity and vibrato throughout the day anyway that sometimes it'll spill over on you. If you come to him and you acting like a dude too, then, you know, now he got to go ahead and show his authority by handling you in a way that he said, I don't want to handle you like I handle dudes on the street.
He
you
was shut down. Mm-hmm.
You'll shut down that
He would completely shut down when it comes to, again, my mother was extremely strong. My mother, I watched my mother when it came to him. There's, there's what, five of us? I watched my mother when it comes to him out of all the kids.
Are you, you have another sister?
Okay. I have a sister,
So it's two girls and three guys.
Three guys,
And that was the other arranged marriage I was talking about.
Where
you come in into a marriage with the courtship, you leave that way. So you still have to go before the Kingsman and say you want to leave this marriage.
Mm-hmm. You got to answer somebody.
You have to answer to somebody. Yeah. That's the accountability you were talking about.
And is it hard to get out?
You got the whole village on you.
Dude,
it's not just one person and a judge. No, you got the whole village. You got his family, her family. Everybody right here.
You got to sign off when you walking away from that marriage.
Correct. Mm-hmm. Correct. Mm. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's real. They just know irreconcilable differences. Yeah.
Exactly. Okay. Well, what you going to do about it? Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then everybody, your uncle, your granddaddy, everybody got to be there. No, seriously.
They got to be there.
Absolutely. Everybody up in this thing. Did you hear? No, you whispering next to each other. You're not even calling on the phone. Everybody right there. It's a whole village meeting. Man, it is.
And so your sister was married before in arranged marriage?
She was in arranged marriage, and he had to go before our uncles and our fellow kinsmen and say why he wanted to depart from the marriage. So it's not something where you could just come in and say, okay, I want a divorce. We're not like the U.S. where you just
sign
a piece of paper and that's it. No, you can sign that too, but you about to stand in front of the whole jury and say what happened. So your indiscretions might come up.
Yep.
Hers might come up. Whatever it is, it has to come up.
You know, I respect that a lot because we assemble everybody when we get married. You know, we say, we send out invitations, we all come here, and even the fusing of the bloodlines, typically you have the bride side on one side, the groom side on whatever, and y'all walk down the aisle and y'all bringing the bloodlines together. Right. But then when y'all get divorced, y'all ain't talk to nobody. Y'all go, y'all don't talk to a counselor to hopefully talk about it, but they hear it through the grapevine. You know, so-and-so ain't married no more.
Exactly.
Like,
gossip out there. Even with that, there's a problem in a household. You don't get to like not go to the elders and talk to them. The elders actually have to talk to you when there is a marriage problem. I think a lot of the elimination of divorces in the U.S. could really be limited if there are elders in place.
Totally agree with that.
Yeah, you don't find too many foreigners getting divorced.
Yeah,
like
it is what it is.
Yeah,
it is what it is.
Get knocked upside your head, go back. Nah, you know that type. Like, go back. Don't hit me upside my head, babe.
Yeah, I know your sister, your brother. You don't want that smoke.
Your
brothers won't have to get it into you because you seem like you put some hands on somebody.
Well, ask that ex one.
She's fast ex.
And their legs now.
And so. So what are the rules of remarrying?
You still have to go back and do the same thing. Diaries of being another arrangement, diary. Well, not even another arrangement. I think because, again, the era is changing. Let's say you do come. So another thing that might happen, a guy and a girl might like each other. You go to your parents and you say, hey, I like him. I like her. Then they start to vet. They start to ask around. Well, who knows such and such.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And then everybody start trying to find out what type of debt they had in their family. Did they have any type of diseases? What do they do for a living?
Occupation.
What type of schooling? They have a pet, cat, dog, whatever. Like, everybody get asked about what their uncles did, their cousins. Like, what does that mean? Do you have criminals in your stuff, in your bloodline? They want to know all this stuff because, again, you're mixing bloodlines together.
Yeah.
And then that's when the guy, their family goes to the girl's family and saying, we come with, you know, we come with humble hearts, we come with greetings saying that our child, our son wants to marry you.
Because the man always goes to the woman.
Correct.
To go get the woman.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. And it has to be agreed upon. You just can't say, well, I'm going to marry her. No, you got to go to my folks. Mm-hmm. Like, come and come tell my dad and them that you want me. Okay. Mm-hmm. Like, this is what this is. So that's really how this goes. You just can't marry out of, oh, that's what I feel. Oh, I love him. Oh, I love her. That's cute and all. Yes. Again, that's Disney. But if we stop to really go with our tradition, yes, they took people and they brought them over here and made them this and that, and things were stripped away. But God said we were made in his own image. So if we're made in his own image, that means those traditions are still within us. So when you start to create, right, that's because the God in you is saying, okay, this is what you want for your household. Mm-hmm. So yeah, that's why you just can't go get any or anybody. You have to vet.
Can you marry someone that's not Nigerian?
He is not Nigerian.
You can. He's not Nigerian.
He's American.
And was that a problem with you?
Everybody, whether you're Indian, African, Haitian, or whatever, you want your child to marry someone of the same culture. That's just what you think about. You know, right. It's like a black-white thing or whatever, right? But then you also, what's greater than that is that you want them to marry the right person for them.
Right.
You know, like, yeah, I can like this, but I know this is better for me.
Right.
This situation. So, yeah, that was one of the things, you know, you have to take a Nigerian wife. Now my sister, like, take a wife. You know, and then it's different with the male and the female. Like, we got a longer shelf life as far as dating.
Yeah,
women, after, it's like they get in a crunch where it's like, okay, I gotta hurry up and make a decision. Yes, I'm 40, but it's not as much pressure on a 40-year-old man versus a 40-year-old woman.
You
know? I mean, y'all can still produce.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
We start to slim out. Yeah. You know, so he's correct.
So you went from, You thought the same thing, he needed to marry a Nigerian woman, and now it's like, just marry a woman?
Always. I mean, that's something we still put on the table. But again, because I know the type of mindset he has, my mother did well with him, right? The family, the village did well with him. I trust his judgment, again, really to a certain degree. And I say that because my discernment will kick in if this individual, again, love God the way we love God, or even better. Why do I say that? Are you fasting? You know, that's a totally different thing. Are you sacrificing yourself for certain things to be better with God, right? That means if he's at the office, you'll feel him before he even calls you. And people don't understand that truly happens. And then, because it's so weird, right? Mm-hmm. When you can discern somebody, or you know the person you're with, you're spiritually connecting, a lot of the times, if they're not accustomed to that type of power, and I say it's power because God gave it to us. Mm-hmm. If they're not accustomed to their own power, knowing that what the person is saying is true because their discernment is kicking in, they're going to think that they're just making up something. But you can't equate God with a human person. That's how amazing he is.
Yeah, it's like that. And you got to think about it from my perspective, me telling a woman I can't talk to you because my sister name don't like you.
I done heard every other excuse. This lame dude done told me his sister don't like me.
Hey, that's it. So regardless of all of the sweet nothing holding hands and we eating ice cream
meals
and everything, meals hanging out, you meet my sister now, you're like, no, I'm like,
But ladies, don't be afraid, because I promise you, I think if the good Lord got you designed for him, the good Lord going to settle me and let everybody know that nothing that God puts together, let no man
teach.
Amen.
So
I'm going to tell you something. If your DM's been popping thus far, they're going to be like overflowing from the Dear Future Wife podcast. Let me tell you something, because I'm going to tell you what just happened. You had your sister cosign on the type of man that you are. Wow. When I say women, that holds a lot of weight. It's like, it's like, because your mom can say certain stuff. Mom be like, my baby's great. They be like, I don't know, that may be a mama's boy or something. You know what I'm saying? Mom always think great. But your sister, they be like, I need to take that seriously. Because at the end of the day, they know that they're going to be friends with this sister. Mm-hmm. And so what's so crazy about it, and this whole platform is all about relationships and love, and I always take it as a great honor when I have a man come on the podcast, because it's so hard to find men that want to sit here and be vulnerable and transparent and own their stuff. But to have you sit down and talk like this and be unapologetic about who you are, where you come from, the culture that you come from, your expectations, your importance on spiritual things and in Christ, and your sister sitting up here saying, this is what I need.
Girl, I mean, Terrence, you got to understand the relationship that he had with my mother when she was alive. It was the most beautiful relationship. It was almost like, from what I can remember, how she kind of had it with my father. She was very gentle with my father. Now, the rest of us, that little short woman was yelling for days. But when it came to him, that's what I was trying to get to earlier. There was a tenderness. There was a soft-spoken woman that has to be masculine all the time, because her husband left her at an early age, right? At such a tender age, he died. And so the way she handled him, I can understand why he wants a gentle person that can speak softly to him, because now you're speaking to his spirit. That's not good. So much so his heart, but his spirit. His spirit would along guide him. God is spirit.
Yeah. So it's interesting. So, of course, you can't tell the conclusion of what the show, how the show unfolds, whether you found love, what happens on it. My DirecTV, I don't know what's going on, but it hasn't been recording the episode, so I got to watch it online or whatnot. I don't know what's going on. Every other season I record it, and this one, just they hating on me. I don't know what's
your
going on.
Your hometown.
Yeah, just hating on me. And so we're gonna work that out. But what was one of your biggest takeaways from Ready to Love?
I would say my biggest takeaway was the intentionality in identifying whether there is a connection or not a connection. Good. You know, and I think what I love about it is that it's speed dating on steroids. Like you're cramming things that you would learn months later in a couple of dates.
Yeah. Mm.
You know, so I'm grateful for that. So now it's like I know what I like. You know, and I know what I want from a woman even more so, because you have to step outside of the box and talk to people that you probably normally wouldn't talk to, you know, in this atmosphere, because you got to give everybody a first shot. So it just really hit home on like that person's inner, you know what I'm saying? Because everybody look good nowadays. Everybody fine. Like, seriously, angles, whatever.
Filters,
bodies, all sorts of stuff. So now it's like, all right, what's the core of that individual? And like now I found I'm better at the discernment and identifying and digging and asking the right questions at the right time.
That's good. Yeah. That's good. How you feel? Like you said earlier, you watched your brother go through this process. You like Mufasa presenting Simba Rafiki held up Simba like that. So that's what, so you're his proverbial Rafiki.
Listen, so far, especially when he showed our mom, it's whoever comes into his life, and we pray, my sister and I truly pray for her already.
Good.
But there's fasting involved too. But whoever comes to him will be the one to feel the love that he had for his mother.
Oh, that's good.
You know, and so this is not just taking somebody because they're fine, right? Now, we want them to look good. Now, hold on. We like to keep our image here. However,
got to be fine.
I'm just saying, we're a fit family. You ought to see the kids. They muscular and stuff. You know? Jeez. But whoever comes, the love that he is ready to give will more than likely resemble, if not even better, than what he had with his mother. And so I'm looking forward to it. I'm looking to finally opening myself up to whoever his mate is, because I tell him all the time, I will block a female in a minute. Okay. Block, you know, because I don't want to invest, because we love hard. In our family, we love real big, right? And so if I'm going to give you a part of what belongs to him, then that means you deserve it. So, you know, I'm looking forward to seeing her one day. Love all of us.
You and I met, you told me this before we recorded this, and I try not to focus on what you were saying because it would caught me in a different mood.
But I'm sorry.
You and I was in the studio years ago with my best friend, God rest his soul.
We love
you. KY.
Yes.
It's the last show that he and I ever did together in 2015. And you were like, I did the voiceover for the commercials. I was like, oh, that was you. I'm not going to go there in my
mind. I'm sorry, because it still hurts a little bit, though, seriously.
That was my boy. So when you said that, I was like, wow, it's a small world. But I love how intentional God is about everything he does. Hey, y'all give it up for my buddy. Naja King. I'm going to call you Naja King.
Naja King, I'll tell you.
Naja King and Olivia. Thank y'all so much.
Thank you.
Thank
y'all so much.
Thanks for having us.
Dear Future Wifey Podcast. Appreciate you.
Ladarian. Thrusted suddenly into Child Protective Services in 2015. My nephew, black, a boy. The likelihood of being adopted outside of kinship, slim to none. Armani, 16 years old, black, a boy, with 5 years in the foster care system before I even knew his name. The likelihood of ever being adopted, yep, you guessed it, slim to none. While Ladarian and Armani were trying to survive and barely thrive in an overpopulated and underfunded foster care system, I was living my own life, doing well professionally. Having been a single father with a daughter who at that point was doing well in college, it was my time to live my life, right? Wrong. I felt unsettled, tireless, agitated. There are just too many of our black children stuck in ambiguity and in the limbo of the foster care system. In 2017, I legally adopted my nephew, Ladarian. Fast forward to 2019, I had no ties to this other young king, but I felt God instructed me to adopt him also, and I obeyed. Starting over with parenting should have been enough, right? Working with various foster care and adoption agencies to help bring awareness to the countless young black kings in the foster care system should have decreased my agitation, right? Joining the board of directors of Advantage Adoption, an organization that helps find permanent adoptive homes for children in foster care, should have led to some type of resolve, right? No, not at all. None of it felt like I had done enough. I now realize that every one of those experiences was laying the fundamental foundation for my life's mission, Kingdom Royale. Kingdom Royale will be a luxury, state-of-the-art home for foster boys. Our first location will be in the Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex. We will utilize the whole person approach that instills identity, empowers them to advocate for themselves, and enlightens them regarding new perspectives and limitless options that they thought were impossible. Though the young kings will attend the local public schools that are in proximity to Kingdom Royale, our at-home curriculum will broaden their worldview through participating in the arts, attending various cultural events, learning about and engaging in multifaceted discussions about current events and even relevant historical contexts, introducing them to gardening and landscaping and even caring for our animals on our farm and on-site stables. We just launched our startup capital campaign with the goal of raising $2.8 million. Now, why $2.8 million? Well, in 2017, I created a web series in which I performed random acts of kindness for targeting the homeless community. One of the most notable successes was that one of the videos went viral, garnering 28 million views. However, one of my biggest regrets is that I didn't raise a single dollar to help in implementing a more sustainable plan for the homeless community. So throughout the years, with much remorse, I reflected on not maximizing that moment. I knew if at that time, just 10% of the viewers donated $1, we would have raised at least $2.8 million that could have really established long-term support for the homeless community, or at least started a long-term initiative to do so. This is my do-over. This is our new beginning. Together, we can attack this at the root by specifically helping our homeless black boys who are already disproportionately represented in the American foster care system. I'm LaTerris R. Whitfield. I've been nominated for 3 regional Emmys documenting my work with the homeless as well as my personal adoption journey. Despite those accolades, the greatest award for me is truly providing the infrastructure for a transformed life. Visit KingdomRoyale.com for more details. Crown a king and make a donation today.
You You know, I've always wanted to have an episode where I talk to someone from another culture, someone that comes from the culture that believes in arranged marriages. I've always wanted to have that. Next time, I think I still want to have the conversation. I want to have a conversation with somebody who, like an older, the older generation, and talk about the impact and the importance of it. That would be absolutely amazing. Well, here's my favorite part of the podcast where I speak to my future wifey. Dear future wifey, we will have an arranged marriage. Our Heavenly Father predestined for us to become one. Guess what? I'm cool with it. I wouldn't have it any other way. Your future hubby.
I hope you enjoyed this episode of the Dear Future Wifey podcast. Remember, be lit, live intentionally and transparently, and don't stop loving.
Make sure to subscribe to our Dear Future Wifey YouTube channel. We're available on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, and Stitcher. We welcome your support. Simply share our podcast with your friends and family.